service of the German Air Force.
It includes the three defendants who are not doctors, and the defendant Rostock, who is an immediate subordinate of Karl Brandt, and the defendant Blome, a medical official of the Nazi Party, and the defendant Pokorny, whom we have grouped under the SS for reasons which will appear later. I will deal first with the military side of the case. Hitler, as Supreme Commander-in-Chief of the German Armed Forces, exercised his authority through a staff called the Supreme Command of the Armed Forces, better known by its German initials OKW, or Oberkommando der Wehrmacht. The chief of this staff, throughout the period with which this case will concern itself, was Field Marshal Wilhelm Keitel. Under the OKW came the three supreme commands of the three branches of the Wehrmacht, the Navy, OKM, the Army, OKH, and the Air Force, OKL. Grand Admiral Erich Raeder was the Commander-in-Chief of the German Navy until 1943, when he was succeeded by Grand Admiral Karl Dönitz. Prior to the outbreak of the war, the Commander-in-Chief of the German Army was Field Marshal von Brauchitsch. In December 1941, Brauchitsch was relieved, and Hitler himself took the position. Hermann Göring was the Commander-in-Chief of the German Air Force with the rank of Reichsmarschall until the very last month of the war. Three branches and its own medical service. For purposes of this case, the medical service of the Navy is not of much importance. During most of the war, the defendant Hahnloser was chief of the medical service of the German Army. In 1944, he was succeeded in this capacity by Dr. Walter. The chief of the medical service of the German Air Force through 1943 was Dr. Erich Hipke. From January 1944 until the end of the war, it was the defendant Schroeder. Subordinate to the defendant Schroeder are seven other defendants from the Air Force. The prosecution's case relating to those crimes alleged to have been committed in the name of medical or scientific research. The charges with respect to euthanasia and the slaughter of tubercular Poles obviously have no relation to research or experimentation, and will be dealt with later. What I will cover now comprehends all the experiments charged as war crimes in paragraph 6 of the indictment, and as crimes against humanity in paragraph 11. It covers also the murders committed for so-called anthropological purposes, which are charged as war crimes in paragraph 7 and as crimes against humanity in paragraph 12. Before taking up these experiments one by one, let us look at them as a whole. Are they a heterogeneous list of horrors, or is there a common denominator for the whole group? A sort of rough pattern is apparent on the face of the indictment. Experiments concerning high altitude, the effect of cold, and the potability of processed seawater have an obvious relation to aeronautical and naval combat and rescue problems. The mustard gas and phosphorus burn experiments, as well as those relating to the healing value of sulfanilamide for wounds, can be related to air raid and battlefield medical problems. Also, it is well known that malaria, epidemic jaundice, and typhus were among the principal diseases which had to be combated by the German armed forces and by German authorities in occupied countries. To some degree, the therapeutic pattern outlined above is undoubtedly a valid one and explains why the Wehrmacht, and especially the German Air Force, was interested in and participated in these experiments. Fanatically bent upon conquest and utterly ruthless as to the means or instruments to be used in achieving victory, and callous to the sufferings of people whom they regarded as inferior, the German militarists were willing to gather whatever scientific fruit these experiments might yield. But our proof will show that a quite different and even more sinister objective runs like a red thread through these hideous researches. We will show that in some instances, the true object of these experiments was not how to rescue or cure, but how to destroy and kill. The sterilization experiments were, it is clear, purely destructive in their purpose. And the prisoners of Buchenwald, who were shot with poison bullets, were not guinea pigs to test an antidote for the poison. Their murderers really wanted to know how quickly the poison would kill. This destructive objective is not superficially as apparent in the other experiments, but we will show that it was often there. Mankind has not heretofore felt the need of a word to denominate the science of how most rapidly to kill prisoners and subjugated peoples in large numbers. This case and these defendants have created this gruesome question for the lexicographer. For the moment, we will christen this macabre science fantatology, the science of producing death. The fantatological knowledge, derived in part from these experiments, supplied the techniques for genocide, a policy of the Third Reich exemplified in the euthanasia program and in the widespread slaughter of Jews, Gypsies, Poles, and Russians. This policy of mass extermination could not have been so effectively carried out without the active participation of German medical scientists. I will now take up the experiments themselves. Two or three of them I will describe rather fully, but most of them will be treated in summary fashion, as Mr. McCaney will be presenting detailed proof of each of them. The first of the high altitude experiments. Subparagraph A of paragraph 6 of the indictment. The experiments known as high altitude or low pressure experiments were carried out at the Dachau concentration camp in 1942. According to the proof, the original proposal that such experiments be carried out on human beings originated in the spring of 1941 with a Dr. Sigmund Roscher. Roscher was at that time